the national anthem.
Forged from the love of liberty in the fires of hope and prayer, with boundless faith in our destiny, we solemnly declare. Side by side we stand, islands of the blue Caribbean Sea. This our native land, we pledge our lives to thee. Here every creed and race find an equal place, and may God bless our nation. Here every creed and race find an equal place, and may God bless our nation.
Ladies and gentlemen, we paid respects to the great nation called Trinidad and Tobago. Now let us pay our respects to the Almighty. Brother Harry Pasad Pasad.
Eternal Father, O compassionate God, we seek your divine presence amongst us here this morning as we observe the 25th anniversary of a great organization in this country, the Trinidad and Tobago Association for Responsible Persons. O Supreme Being, O Divine Light, may your divine light and powers shine upon each and every one of us here this morning. Touch the hearts and mind of each and every one of us who have gathered here this morning. Keep us and bind us together in positive relationships as we continue to serve for the betterment of our beautiful country, Trinidad and Tobago. Almighty God, we give thanks to you for all that you have done for us, for your guidance and protection, especially at this time when this country is about to observe our 56th anniversary of independence. We ask you to continue to look upon us. May your hand of blessings continue to reach out upon each and every citizen of this country, including visitors to this nation. We ask you on this day to bless our office holders, our President, Her Excellency, who is present amongst us here this morning, as well as all others who have taken the responsibility of leading this nation. And this morning we call upon you, as we have this exhibition here to observe our 25th anniversary, guide and protect each and every one of us. Let the initiatives of this organization be a fruitful one, and continue to bless them all in their minds and hearts, so that they continue to serve our beloved nation with peace, with love, and with harmony. We thank you, dear God.
I want to ask for two visions. One, first, to welcome Her Excellency, our first female president and the latest recipient of the Order of Trinidad and Tobago. And thirdly, she is a TTARP member. I think the record social since 2003. So welcome one of us. Thank you. Thank you, Madam President, for your presence here this morning. And secondly, I want to say, TTARP members, let's just give ourselves a great round of applause. We are 40,000 strong, and this here this morning is really a small microcosm of what is the organization. I'm required to introduce the president of the organization, the long-standing Mr. Peter Payne. But before we go to that introduction, I think we should really also acknowledge the contribution over the last 25 years. Peter was one of a few people, and I really think we should call their names this morning. Maurice Kennell, Steve Castani, Ken Gittins, and Vernon Glean, along with Barry Edgill. I think this morning it is really Tony, Peter, and Barry that are here with us, because I understand that Steve has had a mishap, and I certainly hope that he has an insurance, because they said he fell and broke his leg or something like that. I certainly hope that he has insurance. But so Barry, if you could just stand and let people know who you are, because and let us all recognize the contribution of Barry Edgill. And ladies and gentlemen, we will now, I would like to have Mr. Payan come up, and he says that I make sure that I pronounce his name properly. Mr. Payan, Peter Payan, President of TAP.
Mr. Subero, special greetings and good morning to Your Excellency, Paula-Mae Weeks, also to our specially invited guests, also to our corporate sponsors, also to distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and last but certainly not least, to our fellow members of TAP. Special greeting to all. This is our 25th anniversary, and we decided to commemorate it in a special way by having this exposition, which, as you can see, a lot of hard work went into, and I think we should applaud all the people who were responsible for doing this. Please give them recognition. Now, as you know, TAP has certain objectives that we have set out to achieve. One is to enhance the quality of the life of mature citizens. Another is to promote their independence, dignity, and purpose. The third is to lead in determining their role in society. And the last, and perhaps most importantly, to improve the quality of their of our golden years. And I think it would be fair to say that an objective assessment of those objectives would suggest that we have been able to achieve them significantly, and as witnessed by the fact that as of now, TAP has more than 40,000 financial members. Now, understand the significance of what I'm saying. Not 40,000 members, some of whom may be financial. We have 40,000 financial members. And so this is something that we should be very proud of, and indeed, we are. And so as we welcome our patron, Her Excellency, who, as was mentioned, is also a member of TAP, it gives me great pleasure to again welcome you all and to invite Her Excellency to do this symbolic cutting of our cake.
Do you remember the 21st of September? Love was changing the hearts of pretenders while chasing the crowds away. Hearts were ringing in the key that our souls were singing as we danced in the night. Remember how the stars threw the night away. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, Her Excellency will now be invited to view the boots.
Heavenly shades of night are falling, the guitar is cutting off. Out of the mist, your voice is calling, it's twilight time. When purple-colored curtains mark the end of day, I'll lay you, my dear, at twilight time. In the afterglow of day, we'll keep our rendezvous beneath the blue hair. Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping, and a vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone in narrow streets of cobblestone, beneath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar to the cold and damp when my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence. Of silence. My old friend, I've come to talk with you again because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping, and a vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound.
The lady that every time I open my newspaper, I tend to see that she is doing something. Miss Angela Loy happens to be a very active person, giving contributions either to the government, some government committee, or involved in some business venture. And I think that spirit is demonstrative of the TTARP. It is not she's flying in the face of aging. She continues to give and give and show a spirit, and a spirit which I have discovered this week is really what I call earthquake resistant. The TTARP members, I think we've got to show that we are earthquake resistant. A gentleman wrote a column last week and talking about the 12%. There's the 1%, and we are the 12%. We are the Asian ones, and we are 12%. So I think we have to show and continue showing all forms that the 12% are earthquake resistant. And a good example of that resistance is Ms. Angela Lee Loy. Ms. Lee Loy.
This is the challenge. All protocols observed. Good morning. Now, just to prove that, in fact, I am a member, there is my TTARP card, okay? As soon as I reached the qualifying age, I immediately went and get it. And it's very near to my credit cards, because anywhere I go, I say, do you accept TTARP cards? I don't care, and if you haven't, you should really make sure that you become a provider. So, having said that, I am unlike some people. To see far, I need the glasses. To see near, and I can see all of you, I don't need my glasses. So it's not vanity in this particular case. I would like to congratulate TTARP on their 25th anniversary. I think we must not underestimate the power and the influence of those approaching and in retirement. Half of today's 60-year-olds will live to at least age 90, and I am definitely in that era. According to Lyndon Grattan and Andrew Scott, the authors of the book called The 100 Years, I think one of the things that certainly as senior citizens we offer is wisdom. And the reason we can offer that is simply because of life experiences. That takes time to get. And with those experiences, give you the wisdom of how to deal with certain circumstances, such that with young people, you can teach them self-esteem, self-fulfillment, and also we are looking at the fact of self-discipline, which, you know, young people today really need. We have the millenniums, and they feel they could do anything. I still think they still need to be calmed down a bit. My own people, I say to them, I know Facebook is like going for a glass of water. So am I going to stop them from Facebook? No. To manage those people, I need to learn how to manage them. One of the things I thought was interesting, I think most of us know Betty White, okay? And she said, now that I'm 91, as opposed to 90, I'm much wiser, I'm much more aware, and I'm much sexier. I thought that was the best, okay? So let's look at it for us who are aging towards 90. Now, many executives are now rethinking what it means to retire. And I think a lot of people look towards retirement as something great. They're not scared of it, because hopefully over time, you have provided towards your financial acumen in terms of being comfortable. And as you get older, your needs are less. You've acquired, okay? So as a result, you have much more time, I would say, to make a significant contribution to society in doing charitable work with NGOs. And I think it is true to say that many NGOs benefit from people who are retired, who are willing to give up their time and their expertise. And I always say, if you have a board of directors, you need to have skills. Legal skills, accounting skills, marketing skills. So when you look at it, throughout, I'm sure, this entire organization of TAP, there are people with those skills that can give back to society. And a great part of the role that I think senior citizens do is, in fact, dealing with mentors and also mentoring, as the case might be. Many of our young people need that. And so, therefore, it does help that you are able to deal with that. Anyhow, the other thing I think is the fact that we have some of the things I want to really consider is, besides voluntary work, I know many of you have grandchildren. Isn't it wonderful? I have a grandniece that, as far as I'm concerned, is my granddaughter. So I could find every reason why I should reach to Washington. And therefore, if it was only to wash clothes, dry clothes, fold clothes, pack clothes, clean the kitchen, clean the stove, sterilize bottles, put the baby to sleep, to me, that was it. So I could find every reason if I went somewhere else. Washington isn't so far, maybe I should just step over there, because it's a great joy. And I think also is the appreciation that parents have, having grandparents who can help mind their children while they go to work, and to also mentor their children. And I have found whenever, because I deal with a lot of young people, and or even older people, and I talk who have done well, the common denominator is grandparents' influence. So do not underestimate how powerful you are in that role. And I think it is important that you imagine what you can seek to do. The other thing that I think I want to also mention, that I think professionals who have retired are making great strides in this country. And the reason being, if you look at some of them, I can think of Richard Young. He's now the chair of Trinidad and Tobago International Financial Center. I can think of Munilal Lalchan, who has accepted being the chairman of the Office of the Procurement Regulator, which is new. You can think of Clive Belgrade, St. Vincent de Paul. You can think of a lot of people who are in NGOs and fabulously giving their expertise to these organizations. And the thing is, they give so generously, it's unbelievable. Another thing I think that we also, in the age retired people do also, is the emotional support and friendships which we give to encourage the next generation coming up. Because the thing is, we as parents and also grandparents have to encourage our kids to be collaborative and get them involved with seniors as mentors through their regular visits that you make to them to encourage them to become better. The other thing I think you have to understand is because to a great extent, we are the money earners, we are the spenders. In the house school, you know, very often we are the ones making the decisions how the money is going to be spent. And therefore, the economic aspect of what we do is important in terms of how money is spent within this country. So again, if you look at the statistics, it is showing you that the older people are really the ones that drive the economic figures in terms of the spending in the stores. So that is another area where we are important. And the thing is, I think more and more companies need to relook at the strategies they're doing in terms of their marketing to be all-inclusive to the aging population, not to segregate it, because we really pervade all the aspects of economic drive. I would like to say, because I know I'm only allowed 5 minutes, is that I hope that the couple of points that I've given you are useful to show how important our role is in the development of economic development within this country. So it's your time, your mentoring, the spending, the help with your grandchildren and children are all important aspects. But the most important thing is that you have to see for yourself the role you can play in contributing to this society. But one of the things that I also think that people have and do not underestimate is the power of your network. And I'm going to give you an example of that. You know, with the hurricanes that happened, Dominica and all the islands were affected by Irma and Maria. Living Waters had a lot of stuff, how they were going to move it. We needed also warehousing space in different areas. So I donated beds, and AdFoam said, okay, I can give you pillows for every bed you buy. I then said, well, and then I said, by the way, do you have warehouse space? He says, yes, you could get my warehouse space in Glamorgan and East, fine. Now we needed warehouse space in town. I go to Robert Bermudez, being indoctrinated as a chancellor, and there I see Gervais Warner, the CEO of Neil and Massey. And I say, Gervais, I need to ask you for warehouse space, because I know Hilo would have all over in town. He say, okay, I'll give you a number any night. So when I didn't see the number, I call him, where's the number? He gives me the number, I get the warehouse space. The other thing is, now we have all this stuff, how are we going to get it to Dominica? We have to go through St. Martin. We need something to move it. Okay, so I call Kirk Duncan at Pilots and Burton. He says, oh, Angela, we manage the waters. We don't really have a badge. I say, okay, well, who has it? So he tells me, I call at NGC, and yes, I say, could you give us, I understand you have a badge. Okay, Angela, I'll call you later. Calls me 7 o'clock in the night, yes, you can get the badge. I said, but here what, do I have to pay for the fuel? Because that's the expensive part. And says, I'll call you back in an hour. NGC took the entire badge and gave it as, you know, for free, as their CSR. So there we got the badge. Then, I mean, just to show you, somebody would say, okay, I have stuff, but I need pallets. You see that thing called WhatsApp? Fabulous. WhatsApp. I have pallets. Okay. Then the person said, okay, I have my goods on pallets, but now I need it shrink-wrapped. Somebody say, I've got shrink-wrap. Fine. Then somebody says, okay, we have these containers, but We have to pay now. And we're getting a 40-foot container filled for $800. Give me a break. That is charity. Charity at $800. So I was part of the joint chamber and I sent out an email. Hey guys, we need money now. $800. So we got Ron Harford, and Ron Harford gave us 60,000 TT. We were able to move, but it was just absolutely amazing of what was capable of being done. So one of the powerful things we have as we age is our extensive network. As I say to people, I've been on this earth so long, that's why you'll think I have a great network. But you know what? Everybody has a network, and it really is us being able to use that network in a positive way. So I think I've taken over my 5 minutes and they'll kill me. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Angela. There are a number of positive points that were made in that one. And the one that stays with me is the power of the network. We all have it. And the fact that we have 40,000 members, that is a good example. Let us start. Let us continue networking. Because in the face of it all, those are the positives. We get the negatives that we are just now old people and we should probably be pushed aside. But in the face of that, Angela is saying the antidote for all of that, all of the negatives, is really TARP. And TARP, the 12%, and as I said earlier, we are earthquake resistant. I've been told that I missed Miss Patricia Crossley as an executive member. And Miss Crossley, can you please stand and let them recognize? Sorry, I did not recognize. Your name was not inadvertently listed here. And I also want to recognize the presence of the wife of former president, Mrs. Azalea Hassan Ali. I think you could probably stand up and wave your TARP card, Mrs. Hassan. I'll wave your TARP card and tell them that you're one of us. You didn't bring it? It's in the car. Okay, all right. Thank you for your presence, Mrs. Hassan Ali. Right now, we are moving to the feature address. And interestingly, in The Guardian, my fellow columnist, Wesley Gibbons, wrote a column earlier this week about the 12%. And in that, he identified the person coming on stage as one of the persons that he loved most in the world. I didn't realize that. I didn't realize I had competition. You know, I too. But he said that he loved her most in the world. So I don't want to get into a tit for tat with Les. But I think when she's finished, I've heard her before many times, and Dr. Jennifer Rouse, Director of Aging at the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services, I think when she's finished, you too will find that she is among the best lovable persons that we know. Dr. Rouse.
Pleasant morning, ladies and gentlemen. All protocols observed. I used to think, before I am now in my 60s, by the way, and it's not a sales pitch I'm trying, but I always would hear the seniors say that death is the greatest leveler. But now that I am in this esteemed group of seniors, I've been able to switch that to say age is one of the greatest levelers. Greatest levelers. Somebody asked me, I think it was yesterday, where I was on the road, you know, and they say, you look so young. I said, don't put youth on me. I'm not, youth is too much stress. I good here. So I'm not distracting any day, any year, or any hour, because when you come into the aging process, consciously being informed, and I realize that is what a lot of seniors who fear aging suffer from, that lack of information of knowing what it means to be an elder, because an elder is not just a senior or an older person, you know. An elder are those who are over 85. Those are where the air is rare. They don't talk much, according to the saying, speak when spoken to, answer when called. Because they have just lived long enough to know. They have become the repositories of wisdom, holders of history, and as one author put it, keepers of the meaning. They never qualified meaning of what. But it is just taking in that all and being continuously active. Your persona doesn't have to change because you are growing old. Growing old is part of the process, and it is inevitable. Because all of us, or I should put it in another way, none of us is getting out of life alive. So let us start there. Now you could put it in a very crass way and say, all of we are dead. But no, you don't want to rush it. But none of us is getting out of life alive. So immediately you have to check yourself and realize that every moment that we are here is a precious one. And you have to check yourself again in terms of how am I using those moments, because they add up. How do we deal with worry? What is it that we carry with us? As the young people now say, your totem feelings. You don't need that. But you still have to understand that there is a way of expunging them, of expelling them, and then knowing the feeling that you get when you're free of them. It's a freedom you can't describe, you know. You can't describe it. It's not quantifiable. But you know it when you're there. Because you walk lighter. So I'm not one for too much cosmetics. So yesterday I happened to tell one of my young friends that I'm coming to this function today to do the feature dress. She said, well, you have to wear red nail polish. I said, no. If I wear any nail polish, it must be subtle, you know. She said, no, man, you had to be in the game. Now, there's the language. So they put me, including one nail with sequins. I don't know the meaning of it, but I say, wear it. Now, what that does, we have to learn and understand that for the very first time in the world, our generation, most of us here are baby boomers, most of us, and those are the ones born between 1946 and 64. We are now living with four other generations at the same historical cohort. Never before in the history of the world that has happened. So we have those who we call the traditionalists that were born before 1945, right here. We also have those coming after the baby boomers, which are the one 1965 to 84. Those are Generation X. And then we have from 1985, now the cohorts start to get smaller. Instead of 20 years, now it's 10. So from 1985 to 94, we have Generation Y. And it is the very staff in my department that said, well, hey, we now have Generation Z. Now, you know, our generation know the pronunciation of that as Z. We don't know Z. We not there. You understand? We know that during this time, is August vacation, we do not know summer. I'm just letting us know, keep it real. But we have to also understand, don't be hostile, don't be antithetical to the youths, because we live in all together at the same time. And what is interesting that I always say, the macroeconomists, the microeconomists, they try to give us trajectories on when we supposed to die. And we mash up all of that already because we are not dying when they predicted that we should be dead. So it means something we doing right in terms of how we live. Now, many people have asked me, what is the recipe? Eh? But you can't just rattle off the recipe because, you know, you could see an outfit and say, I want that, but you ain't gonna look the same way. You know that? So it is a matter of understanding what is required, but then it redounds to what you, the individual, bring to it. What old people will call the kusume, the seasoning. That's you. And each of us has that certain special seasoning that gives us that diversity, so that the diversity that we see among the group of seniors is the same and proportionate to the diversity that we see in the total population. Now, I have given you the lighter side of aging, the fun part, but aging is a serious issue. As a matter of fact, it's a critical issue. Because if we do not have the systems and structures and the institutional arrangements in place to treat with this group, then we would have fallen short. Because right now, and that was at the last census that was done in 2010, because we do census every 10 years. At that census, we were reading 13.4% of the total population that is aged over 60. So that is roughly about 177,000 plus people. But we are now in 2018, just 2 years short of another census. So we cannot still be at 13.4 when by 2025, we're gonna be 17.5. And by 2050, we're gonna be 30%. So I always ask the rhetorical question, are we ready? Because readiness doesn't only mean we're waiting on the government, because we who are here and alive and experiencing this aging process, we will always be steps ahead of the institutional arrangements, which is why there will always be structural lag in the governmental system. They will never be abreast of where we are. So I have to really give plaudits to Peter Payne. I hope I pronounced your name right. I get that glimpse. Because for some reason, the universe keeps throwing two of us together all the time. When I started my first job after leaving school, I entered in LIAT airline. LIAT was then partnered with BWIA in Sunjet House. Who was working there? Peter Payne. He was head of data processing. It wasn't known as computer and all these high technology things. Peter Payne was there. And then, when I left, I went to TTAS. He was the first manager of the first air bridge between here and Tobago. That is Peter Payne. And then when TTAS merged into BWIA, and I remember him telling us, because we had one of the most wonderful working experiences in TTAS, and he came to us and said, y'all, don't be too anxious to merge with BWIA. You will get subsumed. You're going to lose your identity. I remember him saying, but guess what? We just know that we're going to be in a bigger airline. We just know that the salary going to be bigger. So, not understanding that small is beautiful and less is more. But we found out the hard way. So we merged, and that was it, you know. We blended, and then had to go through all the turbulence that BWIA, and where is BWIA now? In the mortuary. That is no longer even a brand. Peter Payer, that man. But why I made that contextual statement, not just to let you know that we have been together long, but it was in BWIA where I ended up being pension officer in the Provident Fund and Pensions Department, of which he was a member. But what he noticed when he left BWIA was that he was attending funerals of a lot of his peers, and mostly they were men. And he didn't have any statistical data to go by, but he was just looking at direct observation and saying, wait a minute, something is wrong here. Because he has always been a visionary. And he flagged that and says something has to be done where when these men leave their jobs, because most of them who died, they were dying between 60 and 65. And he said, no, 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 no. And that was the impetus for him to commence TAP, Trinidad and Tobago Association of Now Responsible, not retired, with emphasis on retired, but responsible persons. And I only know this because as a student at the time in doing my thesis, I had to get data from Trinidad. And 18 years ago, I was sitting with Mayling, Younglao, who Peter assigned me to get the information on what is this group you all starting? What's the genesis of it? And this is why I'm able now to report back to you what I got for free and was able to incorporate that in the thesis. And so that whole element of what makes a visionary, what makes a pioneer, it requires courage, it requires risk, it requires commitment, it requires leadership, and most importantly, it requires humility. Let people miss you. Don't let them see you all the time in front of their face, because that is not what it's about. It's about the work that you put in the engine room, so that when you are seen, it is always fresh. And that's what he was. And so TAP, some of us here may not be here to celebrate the next 25 years, and we have to accept that. But it means, and I saw it in an app I got recently, many of us are going to plant the metaphorical or proverbial trees, but they are not to give us the shade. We just have to plant it. That is to give others the shade. And this is how I see TAP, because it is not going to retract, it is going to reduce, because the rate at which we are aging and how we are aging and living longer, because life expectancy now in Trinidad is an average of 78 years for men and 81 years for women. And in Trinidad right now, we have over 200 centenarians, with the eldest being 212. So we have to understand that many of us here in this audience are going to be centenarians. But we must understand too that in the culture that we speak of, that ageism, which is the discrimination against not only the elders, but it's also discrimination against the young people who, when they leave school and start looking for jobs, every employer wants experience. How are they going to get experience when we are here? That's what our role is. We are not only to be, as our previous speaker said, to be mentors, but we have to be those tomato steaks. We have to be the exemplars in, as Mahatma Gandhi said, model the change you want to see. Because you don't have to be talking and talking and talking. And then again, using technology that you can use to your advantage of sharing that message in nanoseconds. But what I like with the seniors and the elders is that irrespective of how much technology comes on stream, the young will always have to sit at the feet of the elders. I don't care what you say. Because you see, with the wisdom, with the emotional intelligence that now is more masterful, you don't realize that in the presence of an aging person who has aged right, and when I use that word right, I'm not saying that subjectively that they're aging the way I would like, you know. There's a mellowness. There's an energy that is engaging that comes around them. And that the moment you come into their field of energy, you understand and you bring it down. Not with all the hype and excitement and the frivolity. You just bring it down. Because they listen more than they speak. And that is an art that many of us fail badly in, how to listen. Because elders listen with their skin, not their ear. They listen with their skin. You hear old people say, my skin ain't take you. They know what they mean. And it's never wrong, eh? Never wrong. So I want us to understand that when, and I'm leaving you all with this, that when the division of aging began in 2003, aging then was a social issue. So we had to do a lot of public education and campaigns to raise that awareness. But now, August 15th, which was 10 days ago, the division was 15 years old. And I am able to see, in looking back, that we have now morphed from being a social issue to now an economic issue. So that this group of us who are aging well and living long, we are now being seen as a burden on the treasury. But we now have to change that thinking to ensure that instead of being a burden, we are a resource that can be drawn upon for talents that are unknown, buried, as well as expressed. So I want us to leave with that hope. I want us to understand the power that we have, and I want us to understand that we have to model how it feels, how it means to age, and what it symbolizes. So with that, I congratulate TTARP for being an honorary member, because I'm a member of the group, and I wish them much longevity in years to come, because we are definitely in an aging revolution that we are esteemed to be a part of. Happy anniversary to TTARP on their 25th, and may they see many, many more. Thank you so much.
We want to keep on moving on, and I would like to call on Ms. Mayling, Younglao, Honorary Secretary, to come forward and give a vote of thanks. And there's a lot of thanks that Mayling has to give, because they're putting on this function, and the speakers, Angela Loy, Dr. Rousse, Peter Pena again, and all of it. So you have a big task ahead of you.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning, all. To give thanks is always a pleasure, and I get all the pleasurable jobs to do. So first, I would like to thank Her Excellency for being here with us this morning and gracing us with her presence. I also want to thank and recognize Mrs. Hassan Ali for being here with us. Her husband was a past patron, and I ask our president, TTARP President Peter Pena, to please come forward and show Mrs. Hassan Ali our appreciation, please. Okay, her assistant will take the bouquet from Peter, sir. Well, we heard all what Dr. Rousse said about our president, Peter Pena. And evidence of all of his managerial skills you can see today with our 25th anniversary. And we want to honor him with a small token of our appreciation. We love you. I know we give you a lot of trouble, but we thank you. Give him a minute. Get up. Peter, please come forward. Okay, our president wants a lady to give it to him, so. Our featured speaker, the most knowledgeable person I know on age and aging, and I can sit and listen to her forever. Dr. Jennifer Rousse, we thank you, we thank you. Angela Lee Loy, when we called on her, did not hesitate to come forward and bring greetings to our function. We say thank you and we show our appreciation. To all our gold sponsors, Republic Bank, that has always been with us over the years, they do not hesitate to support us in our 5Ks, our Christmas functions. We say thank you. AA Lakis has been with us for over 25 years also. We say thank you. And we were fortunate this year to welcome again RBC into our folds. We say thank you. To all our silver, bronze, and premium exhibitors, we say thank you. And we depend on you for all your services that you give to our members. Thank you ever so much. We thank Jack Warner and the Center of Excellence staff. As an NGO, we could not have afforded all of this that you are seeing. But they were very good to us, so we say thank you to Jack Warner and the Center of Excellence staff. Brother Hari Prasad Maharaj, thank you. We thank you and note that you are now a proud TTARP member, okay? Thank you. Mr. Peter Campbell and Francis Joseph, protocol, we say thank you. I don't know where you all are, but thank you ever so much. I mean, we give you a lot of trouble, but thank you. All our volunteers, because without them, I don't know what we will do. Particularly though, Merle Henry, Patricia Hutchinson, Pauline Lawrence, we say thank you, thank you. I know we have you every day for the past 2 weeks, making calls, running and picking and pulling things all over the place. We thank you. To all of you, our beloved members, our zonal heads, on behalf of the executive committee, we thank you. We thank you for keeping TTARP visible outside there. This is your celebration. This is your achievement. So you need to give yourself a round of applause. This event is by far the biggest project TTARP embarked on. And little did we know what we will really bargaining into, we were buying into. You need to keep in mind, though, TARP has only 5 members of staff, 5 persons. And on a daily basis, the phone calls, the individual members that seeking attention and, you know, we have to listen to them, the general members coming in and the normal administration of servicing 40,000 members is a huge task. But we do it because we love our organization and we love what we do. However, there are times there are members of staff, they test me to the limit with the various ways of saying why mailing, how mailing, when mailing, start all over again with the why, when, and how in 6 different ways of telling me. I want to say thank you to these members of staff. And I call on Reynold Cooper, executive member, to officially give the thanks from the executive board members to these members of staff. Reynold?
Thank you, Mayling. When you find yourself in the position to help people be happy and feel blessed because God is answering that person's prayer through you by adding value to their life. On behalf of the President, Board of Directors, and members of TARP, I sincerely thank the following 3 persons who participated and led the process of establishing this 25th anniversary expo, which is a resounding success. In recognition of their exceptional service, I now call forward the administrative officer in TARP's office, Denise Joseph. No, they are not aware of this, yeah? This is the first time that they are hearing their names called, so this is supposed to be a surprise. The next person I want to call forward is TARP's hard-working marketing officer, Michelle Nunes. And last, but by no means least, a TARP member who volunteered her services on a daily basis, none other than Louise Komena. Next step. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the next item on the agenda is to declare the expo open. Before I do this, I crave your indulgence to say the TARP's prayer, which goes like this. It says, Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us together this day. Be with us as we come in fellowship to implement this 25th anniversary expo. We thank you for allowing us to enjoy our golden years together as we ask you for health, strength, wisdom, peace, and a grateful heart so that we can assist our fellow man. at the end of our activities today, take us home safely to our beloved ones. To continue to love and serve you, we praise and thank you. Amen. And in closing, let me thank Mayling, forever young Lou. That's why I call her, for her vote of thanks. And the president and directors of TTARP, distinguished guests, partners, corporate sponsors, volunteers, ladies and gentlemen, it is now my honor and pleasure to declare the TTARP 25th Anniversary Expo officially open. Thank you, and let us celebrate our 25th anniversary together. May God bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, this brings to the end this morning's today's functions. Later on, we have, please join us for the health seminar, and of course, it is open tomorrow. So please, you are invited to tour the booths, and there'll be entertainment. Thank you all for coming out. Thank you very much.